You're listening to the audio production of The Expectation Gap Audio Study, The Tiny, Vast Space Between Our Beliefs and Experience of God, by Steve Cuss, published by Zondervan and read by the author. These audio studies are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, this production includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
The therapist asked, "Where is home for you?" And as soon as he asked that question, Paddy knew exactly what he was talking about. He wasn't asking the location of a house. He was asking where she went to feel completely herself, connected to God, and fully loved. Paddy had reluctantly come in for therapy after realizing that she couldn't process her trauma on her own. She'd spent the first session pouring out her recent story, what happened to her, the breach of trust, the subsequent flooding and behavior she couldn't manage. The therapist had discerned that Paddy was living in hypervigilance. She had struggled to let her guard down and relax. The wounds had made her cagey, wary even of the people closest to her, and his question was an invitation. "When was the last time you went home?" he asked. It had been a long time. Like many of us, Paddy had gotten caught up in all she had to do and had not carved out time to go home. As the session wrapped up, her therapist gave her homework. He said, "I'd like you to go home before our next session and then come back and tell me how it went." He was inviting her to take the necessary time to connect and heal so that she could be well and thriving again. We could all use more homework in our lives. Home is anywhere where you're fully welcomed and accepted. You're free to love and be loved. Your guard is down. You don't need to strive. You don't need to be anything more than you are. And you're well. You're well with God. You're well with yourself. You're well with your people. You're rejuvenated, breathing easy and thriving. But you're not just receiving, your heart is opened up to freely give to others. Home is not automatically comfort, nor is it safe, but it will always be belonging, a place of encountering love. Home is where you experience God's profound and specific love for you. You're able to relax into it and then generously pour it out to include others, including marginalized people and enemies. If this is home, then the Hebrew scripture word for home is shalom. For most of us, the word shalom makes us think of a greeting or the word peace, and that's a fine start, but of course, shalom goes much deeper than our modern understanding of peace. Shalom has more to do with human flourishing than simply peace. When we translate words from one culture to another, they can lose some horsepower. Shalom is like a vocabulary superfood. It's packed with all manner of meaning and power. Shalom means thriving, wholeness, and that you are well. Shalom is not measured simply through individual wellness. It's intended that an entire community be well. True shalom involves every relationship in society, with God, your people, with strangers, the under-resourced, your enemies, creation, all of it. And to circle back to where we began, it also includes a relationship with yourself. When an entire community is in shalom, the people are well. They're well with each other, they're well with God, and they are well with themselves. And all people are well, not just the well-off or the well-to-do. As I seek to be home with God and as I seek shalom, I've had to learn a new discipline. My tendency is to ask God to remove something so I or a loved one can get shalom. I confess that my default prayer is some version of, "Lord, please remove blank from my life or a loved one's life. Lord, please remove cancer. Please remove this obstacle." Even after all these years, my default belief is that peace and well-being come from absence. So I often want God to take something away, absence of conflict or disease, absence of difficulty or evil people. But the peace of Christ more often infects our situation as it is rather than removing the situation. I've known this to be true for decades, but at the same time, I'm slow to learn it. Or perhaps what's most true is that I'm slow to be okay with that. It's like I know it for a season or I see a glimpse of it, but then my default posture goes back to the God, take this thing away. One way I try to orient around the way shalom works is to intentionally practice relaxing into God's presence. I first learned this mostly out of survival when I was a hospital chaplain. The onslaught of death and trauma and cancer diagnosis and general suffering was overwhelming, and I was drowning in all that was going on in me in response, and I couldn't manage myself or the pressure to say the right thing or to do the right thing. I so desperately wanted to be helpful to people in the worst moments of their lives, and this was the crucible where I first cut my teeth on looking for God's peace in the midst of suffering and death. I learned to relax into God's presence because I so quickly got to the end of my own presence. My anxiety said, I have to figure it out. I have to know what to say. It's all on me. That my job was to make everything better. And when I was able to notice those triggers, I could pause. I could get off the anxiety treadmill. And I could remember that God was with me and God was also ahead of me with that suffering family. And I could relax. It turns out we can experience home and shalom anywhere. What surprised me most is how that experience has not forged a lifelong habit for me. I need to keep relearning how to practice shalom. I keep defaulting back to the shalom means God takes it away, or finding shalom in my own strength. Another way to say relax into God's presence might be trust God's righteousness over my own. The word righteousness is all through the New Testament, but we often limit its meaning to what Jesus did on the cross, but I find it much more helpful to consider that righteousness in my daily reality, not just righteousness in an event in the past. Righteousness is just New Testament shalom. So when I read about righteousness in Scripture, I think, well, where do I look for my righteousness? What do I depend on to be well? When I forget the Lord, I'm no longer well, because in those moments I'm operating only on my own strength. I've moved into a self-righteousness. Self-righteousness, of course, can come across as if I think I'm better than others. That's maybe the most common understanding of self-righteousness, but actually, some self-righteous people go the other way. They're full of themselves, but it's expressed in either self-pity or self-condemnation. They don't think highly of themselves. They think very low of themselves, but either way, they are still depending on self for what is true and what is right. So arrogance can certainly be self-righteous, but so can insecurity. As we explored when we looked at our inner critics in an earlier video, we discovered that many of us struggle to relax into God because we believe ourselves over God. That is a form of well-meaning self-righteousness. We can't be in shalom when we're depending on self, and that's why I advocate for us to put ourselves on our conscious list of relationships, because if we don't, then we don't actually know ourselves. We are strangers to ourselves. We're disconnected. We're not in shalom. We're far from home. When we pay attention to ourselves and the sort of work I'm advocating for in this video series, we get to know ourselves and we discover all manner of parts of ourselves that are depending on self instead of God. When I first took seriously what was going on in me, I was shocked to discover just how much self-righteousness I carried on any given day. I depended on self a lot, sometimes through high insecurity, sometimes through high arrogance, but always with self at the forefront. As a Christian, it can be alarming to discover just how often you're standing on self to be well, rather than folding your life into Christ. I was both highly alarmed and excited to discover all this self-reliance, as it gave me a lot to repent of, which meant that I had a lot of room for more freedom in my life. When we depend on self, we're bound. When we depend on God, we're free. I depended on self a lot, so I was very bound. And I could repent of that, and I could relax into God's presence and viscerally experience the presence, love, and freedom of Christ that was available to me. I believe repentance leads to truth and freedom, so I became excited to repent. In fact, I did so much repenting in those early days, it became my new hobby. I repented in my spare time. I repented recreationally. I have a few core hobbies. I love good craft coffee. I enjoy a well-made acoustic guitar. I love to fly fish, and I love to repent. I believe the call to repent in Scripture is simply an invitation to shalom, to be well. It's a call to turn around from self and to fold into the righteousness of God. When we repent, we no longer operate under our own steam. We no longer determine what is right and true. We trust that God is right and true. We intentionally believe God over ourself. What about sin? Well, sin is tricky to talk about because our modern minds move quickly to a list of things we should and should not do. When we think of sin today, we first think morality or right and wrong. Sin, of course, is a moral topic, for sure, but the authors of Scripture see sin more as a breach than a list. They talk about it more as a dire severance than ethical commands. The authors of Scripture talk about sin as a condition we're in, more than the things we do or don't do. I particularly appreciate the way Paul talks about sin in the New Testament, especially in Romans, because he describes it much more as a noun than as a verb. For Paul, sin is something we're in, more than something we do. And Paul uses high alarm and warning language to help us stay out of sin's grip. If you pause and read Romans 6, Paul uses very stark language to protect us from sin, because sin entraps, and then sin punishes us without any mercy. Paul says if we're not careful, we'll fall into the grip of sin and it will squeeze the life out of us. Sin kills and destroys. In contrast to sin, God gives life. And Paul says that whatever we give ourselves to, sin or God, it will consume us. So if we hand ourselves over to sin, then sin will be the dominant controller of our lives. If you've ever met someone who has depended on self for a long time, you've probably seen this play out in a tragic way. They may not be a drug addict or homeless, but you can't tell them anything because they always know better. They cannot open their heart up to trust or vulnerability because they can only depend on self to be safe. This is tragic, and this is the destructive power of sin. This is what God rescues us from. Our modern understanding of the way things work is we say that God punishes us when we sin, but most of the authors of Scripture actually point out that sin punishes us when we sin, and God is warning us not to fall into the lure of sin because it will turn on us and it will make us pay. I think we sometimes imagine God as enjoying punishing us when we sin, but when a mother warns her child not to touch a hot stove and then the child touches the hot stove and burns himself, the mother doesn't say, "I was kind of hoping you'd actually do that because I'd enjoy punishing you." More likely, the mother rushes in alarmed. She's like, "That's why I told you not to do it. Let me help you with that burn." It's the stove, not the mother, that did the punishing. A few years ago, I stumbled across the writings of a Catholic priest named Herbert McCabe. And the way he talked about sin stopped me in my tracks. McCabe suggests that the reason to avoid sin is because it pollutes our thinking, particularly our thinking about God's thinking about us. Sin makes us think that God has changed God's view of us. But McCabe proposed that sin doesn't change God's view of us. Sin changes our view of God's view of us. sin infects and distorts our capacity to see God for who God really is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.